In previous videos, we looked at the different macrostructures and pathways of the human brain. But what exactly are these macrostructures made out of? How is the brain organized? And how do the different cells within the brain communicate with one another? How do brain cells work on a molecular level? And how exactly does electricity play a role in these cells' communication? I'm Colin Fosnot, and in this video, we'll talk about how the cells within the brain work. The human brain is composed of around 86 billion neurons. Fundamentally, neurons are the building blocks of the brain. Think of the neurons in your brain as the bricks of a building. Without the bricks, the building would not exist. Some bricks may not be critical to the support of the building, while others are incredibly important to keep the building standing. Certain rooms within the building have specific purposes, but all rooms within the building are built from bricks. In the same way that the bricks of a building are supported by mortar, billions of glial cells support the neurons within the brain to keep them happy, healthy, and functioning properly. Glial cells are essentially the caretakers of neurons, nourishing and protecting them. They are more malleable than neurons and are easier to replace. However, they play a critical role in keeping the brain working properly. Neurons share several characteristics with other types of cells in the body, such as a nucleus and a cellular membrane. They contain three main structural components: a cell body, called the soma, dendrites, and an axon. The cell body houses all of the important structural parts of the neuron, such as the nucleus, whereas the axon and dendrites allow the neuron to receive and transmit information to and from other cells. Dendrites are branching structures that come out of the neuron's soma. They are able to receive electrochemical signals from other neurons, usually in the form of molecules called neurotransmitters. Neurons have many dendrites, all of which form unique connections to other cells. Essentially, dendrites are the way that neurons receive information from other neurons. Think of dendrites like a microphone of a sound system. It allows for new information to be brought in to the system. Like every other cell, the neuron's cell body, or soma, is where a majority of the cell's everyday functioning takes place. More importantly, for the functioning of neurons, the soma is where signal processing occurs. In other words, the neuron's soma makes decisions about whether to fire or not based on the input it receives from the dendrites. The soma is like an amplifier for a sound system. It allows for a signal from the microphone to be sent to the speakers. Areas of the brain where large numbers of somas exist are called gray matter. Gray matter takes up roughly 40% of the brain. The axon is a single protrusion that comes out of the neuron's body. The axon carries electrochemical signals from the neuron's body and communicates it to other neurons by terminating on or close to the other neuron's dendrites. The ends of the axon are called axon terminals. The axon is like the speakers of a sound system. They transmit information to other systems. Areas of the brain that contain large amounts of axons are referred to as white matter. In adults, these areas may take up as much as 60% of the brain. The term we use to describe when neurons fire is an action potential. Action potentials are chain reactions that, once started, cannot be stopped in a healthy neuron. The action potential eventually reaches the axon terminal, where it triggers the release of neurotransmitters into a space between two connected neurons called the synaptic cleft. These neurotransmitters are received by the next neuron's dendrites. If enough neurotransmitters are received by a neuron's dendrites, then the process starts all over again. Action potentials are mediated by ion flow. Ions are molecules that are charged either positively or negatively. By utilizing differences in charge and concentration of different ions, the neuron can generate current in the axon, creating an action potential. This is how neurons utilize electrical energy to operate. The most important ions that neurons use are the negatively charged chloride, positively charged sodium, potassium, and calcium ions. In a neuron that is not excited or stimulated, what we call a resting neuron, there are more sodium, chloride, and calcium ions outside of the neuron than inside the neuron. Conversely, there are more potassium ions inside of the neuron than outside. Due to the fundamental laws of nature, ions naturally moved from places of higher concentrations to those of lower concentrations. This is called chemical force. Furthermore, ions with similar charge move away from one another, while those of opposite charge move towards each other, or electrical force. It happens to be that the linear sum, or combination, of all the different electrochemical forces create an electric potential difference across the resting neuronal membrane with a magnitude around negative 65 to negative 70 millivolts inside of the neuron. This is the neuron's resting potential. Individual neurons on their own cannot give rise to complex cognitive behaviors. Rather, it is the communication between many neurons that gives rise to cognition. There are various ways in which neighboring neurons could communicate with one another. Typically, a neuron triggers or stimulates another neuron via chemical messengers called neurotransmitters. These chemicals bind to dendritic branches, causing specific ion channels to open, allowing these ions to flow into the cell. This is just like a key that opens a specific door and allows people to enter through it. These chemicals then move into the neuron's soma down the concentration gradient. In order to activate the neuron and trigger a signal down the axon, the number of charges or ions from the dendrites must contain enough energy to change the inner potential from the resting negative 70 millivolts to at least negative 55 millivolts. When this threshold is reached, a process called depolarization begins. If the threshold is not reached, the neuron returns to its resting potential. In most cases, a signal generated by neurotransmitters from only one neuron is not enough to raise the inner potential of the recipient or postsynaptic neuron and activate it. Rather, multiple neurons are usually required in order to trigger the next neuron's action potential. Neurotransmitters sent from multiple input neurons accumulate inside the soma near the axon hillock. The accumulation of these charges are summed, and if the threshold potential of negative 55 millivolts is reached, then the neuron activates. The axon terminal then releases its own neurotransmitters. This could trigger the next neuron in the sequence and repeat the process. As mentioned earlier, there are many non-neural cells present inside the nervous system that provide the structural support for neurons. These cells also play several roles in protecting the neurons, maintaining their appropriate environment, getting rid of neural waste, fighting pathogens, and even speeding up the neural signals moving along these axons. These non-neural cells are called glial cells and usually outnumber the neurons within the nervous system. Neurons are very fragile and require a good deal of protection in order to keep them functioning properly. Because of this, the brain and spinal cord are surrounded by bone. The spinal cord uses vertebrae for protection, while the brain utilizes the skull. Additionally, the brain and spinal cord are surrounded by three protective membranes called the dura mater, arachnoid mater, and pia mater. There is also a clear watery fluid called cerebrospinal fluid that circulates in the subarachnoid space between the arachnoid mater and the pia mater. Although the skull and other protective layers surrounding the brain are important for its protection, they also impede the signals produced by the brain, decreasing the ability to record these brain signals from outside the skull. This is a serious problem for non-invasive neurotechnology, since these signals are often distorted or reduced, which can result in a loss of useful information. In this lesson, we learned how individual neurons communicate with one another. In the next lesson, we'll learn how this contributes to cognition at a larger scale.